The first is neuro-linguistic programming, where you're supposed to identify your audience if they're a visual learner or auditory learner or tactile learner. A lot of people seem to think like that's the way to go, and yet I have no idea how to apply that in real life. I have no ability to determine if you're an auditory learner or anything, even on a one-on-one conversation. I don't know. I couldn't even tell you if I'm an auditory or tactile learner or whatever. It just never made sense to me. I can't be bothered to think about my body language or your body language or anything like that. I can really only think of delivering the information effectively. So we are going to jump in, but for people who are listening who are not in any type of sales or any type of speaking, I think this is still 100% relevant. I would say that most of the Nobel Prize winners out there were actually very good salespeople and therefore good communicators. And that's the reason that you heard their name, regardless of what career they're in. Could even be sports and everything. The person who can sell themselves better and communicate better is probably going to get ahead. It's going to make up even for lack of academic or athletic ability, I think. If you can step in and communicate better, it's probably going to get you ahead. And if you have all the skills in the world, but you can't hold a conversation, you can't sell yourself to your bosses or your peers or your audience, then nothing's probably going to happen in your career.
I couldn't agree more. It's lovely to see you. We had a relationship years ago, and as we've discovered, you went to school with our daughter, interestingly enough, which I don't even think we knew when you worked at the gym you worked at before into 2012 before I sent the book to you, before you left there and went to Europe, and I sent you my communications career on June the 14th, 1982, about minus 7 years before you were born, I'm guessing, if you're about
Yes.
Chrissy's age. And I started as a public affairs officer with the government of Alberta in Edmonton, Alberta, when the unemployment rate in Edmonton was 17.5%.
Hard times.
Now, it was very hard times. Fortunately, I drank, I was president of the Students Association at the college I went to, which is this college here, Grant MacEwan College. We drank B-52s with the Minister of Advanced Education, and long story short, I ended up working there. And I actually worked for government for 3 years, 3 months, and 3 days, just
Okay.
by coincidence.
Not a Freemason, huh?
No, not a Freemason, but it was the 333, and I had been self-employed since September the 17th, 1985.
I love the exactitude.
I have a thing for dates, in case you haven't noticed. In March 1987, I packed all my worldly possessions and moved to Toronto, drove to Toronto. For those of you who don't know how far Edmonton is from Toronto, it's 3,600 kilometers. And I set up shop here as a freelance writer. I took on a partner. We had a couple of employees. And at one point, we talked about changing to speech writing and doing speech writing exclusively, which you can do in Toronto because there are enough head offices and there are enough executives. You can't really do that in other places in Canada or in a lot of other markets around the world, actually. Toronto seems to be very unique that way. And from speech writing, training became a natural extension. And I was like you. I thought, you know, I'm hearing all these rules, I'm hearing all these things. My grandfather used to have a number of great sayings, and one of them was, "Common sense is perhaps the least common commodity on the planet." So, what I wanted to do was develop a way of approaching presentations that was natural, that was based in common sense, and it was supported by the research. And that's pretty much how I made my living for many years. Both presentation skills training on one side and media training on the other. And it's what fed our family, put our kids through university, and financed the retirement I'm just starting to enjoy at this point in my life. Beat you over the head long enough and loud enough with a key message that you're going to do what it is I want you to do. And one of the things I have to teach my clients, and I've had to work with in my colleagues in the global communication practice, and on the volunteer side of my life, I've sat on many international committees that are communication based, is teach people that communicating is not about what you say, but what about it's about what comes back. And that you give people ideas with the intent of getting something back. a behavioral or an attitudinal outcome. And probably the best way I've learned to describe that is, I don't know if you know our son, Andrew. I know you know Chrissy, but did you ever know Andrew or?
Only I saw him come into the gym with you a couple of times when he was home from school.
Yeah, so exactly. So first year he comes home from the University of Western Ontario. And every kid in Ontario and every kid in the Western world, as you know, knows that you want to save the planet. You know, save the planet is a good thing, and you have to turn lights off to reduce electricity to save the planet. So Andrew comes home from his first year at Western. I go upstairs in our house. The light's on in his room. It's on in the bathroom. It's on in the hallway. It's on in his sister's room for some unknown reason. And he's downstairs sitting on the couch eating a bowl of cereal, watching sports something on television. And I'm thinking to myself, can't you just turn the light off? And I keep thinking, well, you know, that's a key message. Turn the light off is a great key message.
It's very simple, too.
Exactly. There's no reason why they shouldn't understand it. But then I chastised myself and said, you're a professional communicator. You're interested in the outcome. And the outcome I wanted was for him to turn the light off without me having to tell him to do it. And sometimes you have to change your input to get the anticipated outcome that you're hoping to get. So I stood at the top of the stairs and I said, Andrew, could you please come up and turn off the light? To which he replied, but you're upstairs, Dad. To which I replied, but I'm not the one who left the lights on. So he had to put down his cereal bowl, unwrap his 6'7" frame from in front of the television, walk up the stairs, turn off the lights, and then walk back down the stairs. And it only took twice for him to completely change his behavior forever. So every year after that, he has been fantastic at turning the lights off, to the point that years and years later, in fact, about 6 or 7 years ago, he was living with his girlfriend at her parents. And we all went out for dinner one night, and I said to her mom, to Brittany's mom, I said, how's living with the big guy? And she said, oh, it's awesome. Never met somebody who turns off lights like him. But if I could just get him to put the bloody coffee maker back underneath the cupboard when he makes a pot of coffee, everything would be perfect. But I said, well, would you like some insight on how to do that? She said, sure. So I said to her, don't do it yourself. Have him get up and do it. And I bet it won't take very long. And about a week later, I get a text from Andrew saying, you're such a jerk, Dad. Because she tried it and it worked. So when you ask me, why do these executives need to understand how to communicate effectively, is because every executive I've ever met on the planet, and I had this conversation with an executive, a CEO on Tuesday, has to get people to do things to support the business. That every interaction should be a meaningful interaction in which the business objectives, the executive's objectives, hopefully they're in sync, are advanced, whether you're talking to one person or 1,000 within your organization or externally. To do that, you have to understand that it's not about what goes in, it's about the anticipated outcome that you're seeking, and all of your activity should be focused on that. And that's why strategic communication is so important to executives.